When I first started out in this business, I was just a chef. I wasn't a chef owner. And my job was to write menus and write recipes and cook food all the time and taste and talk to the cooks and do the ordering and scheduling. But it was very simple. When I became a chef owner, I thought it would be the same, but it's totally different. Weeks go by in this restaurant without my touching food.
And braised garlic, and it will come with probably oven roast potatoes and a little pan ragu of asparagus, artichokes, fava beans, and fennel. We will have a Persian-style roast duck with a sauce of pomegranate, walnuts, onions, and tomatoes.
The biggest surprise my family ever had was to find out that I went into the restaurant business. Because when I was growing up, I was the family problem eater. I was the kid that didn't like any food at home, and I wouldn't clean my plate, and when they'd leave the room, I'd dump the milk in the sink. But I loved to eat in restaurants. And those are some of my happiest memories of going out with my parents to eat and eating everything. I mean, they didn't even notice that. Like, I ate everything in the restaurant, didn't eat anything at home. I was a critic, you see, but they didn't appreciate that.
I started to teach very early in my years in the United States, I think 1960 or 61. I came here in 60, and immediately everybody asked me for French recipes. The people who come to me now are restaurateurs, they're chefs, and they really are deep into this so that we can tackle in one day from the artistic angle to taking your spreadsheet, putting it on the table and saying, now look, what's your percent here? Don't you think this is exaggerated? This is where your problem lies. Your rent is too high. Your salary is 40%. What do you think you're going to do with that? Get that salary down and so on to styling your plate.
I think I probably decided that I wanted to cook when I was 9 or 10. But it would never be something that I would have admitted to at the time, because that wasn't a profession. I mean, if somebody had asked me, what do I want to be when I grow up, I would have had to say a doctor. Otherwise, I'd get a dirty look from my dad from across the room.
That is a suction valve.
Right.
And most of those machines don't have it. And what happens is when the pressure is low, you make cappuccino, it will suck some milk inside the boiler. Oh. And that's where you have dirty water, or you have in your steam, a contaminated steam from the burnt milk that it just went inside.
Right.
Yeah, this is an old element that we put it on inside there. And what happens is they may look good, but in general, what we do is we do testing for continuity in one of them. And if sometimes they get a little weaker, that's the time that we say, let's change it. What is missing in this machine, like I said, will be the touch pad and a PC board. They have a brand new PC board, which is the brain of the machine. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's about it. But more or less, this is the concept for rebuilding. When are you planning to open?
In June.
Okay, so we got April and May. Usually, espresso machine, you don't bother probably the last week before you open.
Right.
But if I need to overhaul this,
you
know,
you need
it's like I need time, at least maybe 3 weeks or 2 weeks, tell me start opening. If I have the time, I will open it up. I have your telephone number. I could call you. Listen, you know, if you run down.
I started looking for a restaurant space over a year ago. I was just walking by here one day, and I saw the sign in the window, and I kind of peeked inside, and I thought, it's pretty ugly, but it's brand new. And I thought, I can't be here. You know, I can't live upstairs. There's no garden. There's nothing. And then the more I looked at it, it was within my budget.
Bonjour, you've reached La Midonia. No, we're not open yet, but we're working as fast as we can to be open by late spring. I look forward to cooking for you. A bientôt.
I need to give a lot of warmth to the place because it looks kind of industrial, and it's just one long, narrow room. So hopefully with paint and changing the lighting and, of course, the open kitchen, it'll just create its own ambiance.
I was a restaurateur. Right, I enjoyed it, I loved it. The restaurant was like my home. I dressed like I would dress to entertain at home. I had the same everything as I had at home. So when people came, they said, oh, this is so wonderful. It's like walking into your home. Yes, it was. And this is the feeling I wanted to give because, granted, I'm called a chef, but first and foremost, I'm a woman. And I wanted the food that was on the table to be woman's food and presented in a woman's surrounding.
In a woman-run kitchen, we spend a lot of time talking about taste and texture and harmony of the kitchen and did we please the customers and is everybody happy?
I don't think so.
It's a very feminine point of view that making money is not the most important thing, that making beautiful food and fighting for good quality and tasting was the main thing.
Noodles?
Yeah. We've been sending out overcooked pasta for days.
That's more than I believe more than I normally do. I thought
I
should cook it over too.
Yeah, I think she should cook it over. So that's fine for her.
I cooked it.
Oh, you cooked it? Oh, we shouldn't be doing that.
That's
wrong. We give it a, it's got a Meyer lemon aioli and an artichoke. If you're going to use any lemon, I would use a piece of Meyer lemon.
Do you want Meyer lemon wedges on it?
If we've got it. I don't even think you need it. I don't think you need it. This is pretty tart.
When I first got married, I did lots of cooking and entertaining. When we were living in Rome, I didn't have a refrigerator, so I was forced to market twice a day and talk to purveyors and the butcher and get recipes and find out how to do everything. And I discovered I really had a gift for it, and I really enjoyed it. So with three small children, it was easy to throw them on the floor with pots and pans and spoons and measuring cups and all that stuff and cook. And I entertained like crazy, and I read cookbooks at night, during the day. I mean, I became just a monomaniac.
You only carry Wolf ovens?
I mainly because of what you were telling me about the saute and what have you. That's why I was showing you.
Yeah,
this.
I like these. I like these.
When I get involved with the other burners, I can't.
Those things make me crazy.
Okay, me too. I don't even work in a kitchen, but it's like they drive me nuts.
Cleaning them is already just painful.
U.S. Range, Montague, and what have you have the ring-type burners, so if it overflows, it goes down on the burner, and it's hard to clean and what have you, and, you know, you'll have a mess once in a while. So back to the oven factor, who makes the better oven? It just depends as to which salesman you're talking to. All three of the major manufacturers have a good convection oven.
What's the grill going to sit on?
A stand or an angle. In other words, you know, I'd
just
have a...
Just a table?
Right, table.
There's no way it can sit on an oven.
Yeah, but then it comes up high and...
But the fryer is between them. So let's say if the line starts...
You can't have your fryer next to open burner. You can't have your fryer next to a broiler.
Okay.
Unless you have a shield between the burner and the fryer.
How about if the line starts here, and here's the hood, let's say, and there's a little space there, and we start with here, and then there's a space here, whether it's just a table for putting something, or resting something.
A spacer,
something.
A space plate.
And then the fryer.
Okay, right.
And then the grill.
You could do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then the salamander somewhere in the middle.
Somewhere, right. Yeah. That's convenient for you.
Because then
work.
I salvage the grill, which I really would like to do. I don't want to go out and buy a new grill.
Okay.
Because that thing is brand new.
What were you going to use it for?
For lots of stuff.
Is it a flat grill like this or a broiler grill? Are you talking grill this style or grill this style?
Yeah, like that.
Oh, different. Better. Oh.
So what's your ETA, estimated?
June.
Okay.
I'm praying for June.
Okay.
But my biggest concern is because it's an open kitchen that, you know, it has to
look good,
uniform,
right?
and nice. It doesn't have to be fancy and, you know, have murals on the hood, but I don't, I mean, I think that what I need is pretty basic.
Basic as I know.
Yeah. I started out with a different restaurant supply place, which is supposed to have everything used and on a discount and blah, blah, blah. But I wasn't getting, this guy knows what he's talking about, you know, and he's really, I just get a better feel for him. The other guy, however, has my old stuff that I'm selling. So now I'm kind of thinking, I like the style here better, you know? And so now I'm stuck. So I have to buy some things from him and some things here, maybe, which I don't like to do. I had it all planned. I was going to go to Paris. I enrolled at the Cordon Bleu. The courses were more designed for somebody who wanted to cook at home. The women had to wear these little bonnets, and I was probably the only woman who was going to pursue this professionally. But I learned a lot. I mean, I went there knowing nothing, and I did learn a lot. And most of all, I learned about, you know, food in France and discovering this market that was just near my house on Avenue La Motte-Piquet. I would look into people's shopping baskets, and it wasn't like I'd never seen food before, but I had never seen it this way. The way it was presented, the way it was laid out in the market stalls, I was dazzled. I came back to San Francisco and worked. But I always felt like I still didn't know anything, and there was still a lot that I wasn't getting exposed to, and nobody was going to do it for me, and I had to figure out a way to get back to France and go for another apprenticeship, and this time in a serious house. And so I started to write letters here and there asking, you know, to work for free, and I didn't get any response. You know, I just got a bunch of rejection letters for a long time. And finally, one day, I heard back from Georges Blanc offering me an apprenticeship without pay. Within 2 weeks, I was on a plane, and I landed in Paris and jumped on a train and was suddenly in the middle of absolute nowhere. And the very first day, they had me in the back cleaning peas or something. And before I knew it, I was garnishing plates, and then I was, you know, I was on the line, and everybody kind of looked at me funny at first, and then the chef didn't say anything, and so everybody went along with it. And after lunch service, everybody kind of came up to me and said, "Wow, that's never happened before."
Hi, aren't you a surprise? I'm fine. How are you? This is Miss Finnemore for two. And when you pass by Mr. Hirschfield, would you tell him that Mr. Rosenberg is on his way? He'll be here in a couple of minutes.
Got it.
Kirk, dear, could I have a table for two? So, oh, Gary will get it. Great. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
I like you a lot. I think you're a neat lady.
Well, admiration goes both ways. Oh, I babysat this weekend, both on Saturday and Sunday, and she was a very good girl. And she
took. How old is she now?
She's 6 weeks.
Healthy, fine.
Oh, just delicious. This is a business. And I guess that's always the biggest surprise of going into the restaurant business as a chef. You don't think about that part so much. You think about all the beautiful food you're going to cook and how it's going to look on the plates and briefing the waiters about the cuisine. the worst part of opening is just getting the waiters to pick up the food when it's hot or cold and getting it there in the right state, of taking it to the right table, of not tripping on a busboy. The initial choreography is always problematic. You find out where all the errors are in design when you first open. You find out where people keep crashing into each other, why the coffee station is a nightmare and maybe the desserts have to be moved out of it. You find out all the things that you thought were going to work that are not working, that you have to fix. And I mean, when we opened, I would just walk around with a clipboard for the first 3 weeks writing down everything that was wrong. People tell me now that the food was wonderful. I have no recollection of this. I did lose 15 pounds. I didn't sleep. I ran around all the time. Here you go. Thanks. When we first opened this restaurant, there were just about 8 restaurants in this neighborhood. And now there are 3,000 more seats that you can walk to from this door. I'm not talking about the rest of the city. I'm just talking about within this neighborhood. So you know how the ante has gone up. We fight for customers. And I never looked at it as competition. I always thought we just all sit here and make our art. But my God, I fight to keep my customers coming back.
So it seems to be in us that we definitely have to feed people. And we love to cook because we simply have to feed. Men, on the contrary, seem to have gone through a lot of troubles to learn to cook. They seem to go to school a lot, where that school will give them a commercial mind. The women don't have that commercial mind. It takes a long time to acquire it. Like, I acquired it only on my second restaurant. It was not important for me how much money I made, as long as the food was fantastic. On the second restaurant, I knew how to make the food fantastic and how to keep my finances together well.
Any new restaurant gets the benefit of the doubt for the first year. I think the first year is a free ride. The press comes, you get reviewed, customers are talking about you, you're hot, you're new. So you're getting the benefit of all this attention. What about the guys limping along in the third, fourth, fifth year? They made it to the fifth year, they're not limping. They're sort of, oh my God, I'm still here. That's pretty amazing. 10 years, I consider it a miracle. I feel like a dinosaur, Jurassic Park. I mean, you know, it's that sort of thing.
I was very adamant about not going and asking for money from anyone. I wanted to, and I didn't want any partners, I didn't want any investors. I just felt like the more people became involved, the less it would be mine. And it was very much, you know, my dream and my purpose in life, pretty much. I mean, this is my life. So I didn't want a lot of opinions.
Now, this first wine I'll taste with you is the Malvasia Bianca. And Malvasia Bianca being one of the white grapes that is blended with Sangiovese to make a Chianti. It has just the character of sort of, you know, rose petals and orange blossom, and the nose is almost a little bit misleading because it gives you the impression that it's going to be sweet, but in fact it's dry. It's nice firm acidity.
Was this at that tasting you had back in September? Mm-hmm. It was? I can't remember it at all. What? Where are we on in terms of
price?
Pricing on that?
$100 a case.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, $8.33 a bottle. Okay. Now, I'm happy to taste you on the Cabernet if you like.
What are we tasting in Cabernet?
Well, I brought Frog's Leap.
Oh, just, okay, the Frog's Leap. I thought you were going to pull more out.
No, it's all on the table. Just very deep, dark, rich, extracted, you know, black currants, black raspberry.
By virtue of the size of this place, I think it's going to become someplace that people will feel comfortable coming to twice a week, three times a week, every night if they want to, because they'll know people here and they'll know the cooks behind the line, and they will be made to feel special even if they're stopping by to say hi to me or to the bartender and, you know, maybe just have a bowl of soup.
There are a lot of people who think that they're going to go into the restaurant business and enjoy it, and they hate it. They hate it because it's like the baby that never goes off the 2 a.m. feeding. It's always there. It's always up. It's always running. It's showtime at lunchtime. It's showtime at dinner time, and it goes on and on. You can't say, oh, the hell with it. I'm tired. I'd like to take 2 weeks off. Well, who's going to pay the rent? Who's going to pay your staff? Who's going to pay your purveyors? So you have to really be hooked. You have to love it, or it will be the hardest job of your life.
Hi, this message is for Brad. I'm sorry to call you at home, but I just got some great news today, Brad, and I wanted to share it with you. And I'll try to shop, but this is Donia, and I was just at City Hall, and it looks like we're going to get our building permit on Monday. I know it might not be good news to you, because it's going to mean you know what. We're going to have to start sooner, Bradley. I'm sorry. But anyway, I'm dancing around here. I'm so happy. I'll call you later, and I'll try the shop, and hopefully we can talk this evening. It's about 3 o'clock on, what is today? Friday afternoon. Okay? So I'll talk to you later. Bye. Hi.